Hello, it's Keith here, and this is the second in the simple series of my 65 auto-assembly programming tutorials. In this series, we look at a different system each week, and we do a very simple program example that uses just a single ASM file, so that it's easy for you to port to other assemblers if you prefer, and it'll let you get started with a simple example that hopefully you can build on and make a game or program of your own. Now, today we're going to be looking at simple bitmap drawing on the Commodore 64, so let's switch over to the code and let's see it in action. I always like to run the code as soon as possible and prove I can really deliver the goods, so let's fire it up and have a look. And here you can see, if you see here, we've got a very small, smiley little face, and that's really just the goal of this tutorial today. Now you can see there's some garbage on the screen we've not cleared out, but as I say, just a very basic example today. Now, as well as the smiley face, we also have a more advanced example. If I just, I'll keep this rimmed out for just a moment. And that's our Chibico mascot, you can see it here. And that's just in two colors there, but we can also, if we just remove this rim here, we can also see it in four color mode, because the Commodore 64 has a very nice four color mode, and you can see there's our Chibico character there. There she is. Okay, so let's go over the code today and learn how we can get graphics to the screen on the Commodore 64. Okay, well, the first thing you can see is we're defining a symbol four color, which is either defined or not defined, and we've got some conditional compilation later on, which is going to be using that to change the settings and allow the two modes to work in the same source file. We're defining some zero page entries for our use here. I define them mimicking Z80 registers, so we've got HL for a source, BC for a byte count, and DE for a destination. Start of our program here. If you don't know how to start a simple program and compile it, please see my Hello World series. We already looked at that there, so I'm not going to cover that again today. I'm assuming you're going to have some way of getting a program compiled yourself. Now we need to turn on our screen settings. So you can see we've got some definitions here. We're writing them to various ports here. We are defining the color as black here as for the background. We're setting up our screen here and defining the address. And also we're defining the color mode. Now, of course, that's going to be different depending on whether we're in two color mode or multicolor four color mode. So there's two different definitions here. And you can see there's an ifdef, which is conditional compilation, and we'll switch the four color mode on or off. So that's what we're doing just there. Okay, now you can see here we've got some code to get some data to the screen, and this is the bitmap data, and then this is the color data. And you can see there's two different versions of the color data depending on if we're on two color or four color mode. Okay, now either way, we're going to need some kind of bitmap data. So if we're in two color mode, this is just one bit per pixel. You can see here we've got a smiley, and you can see there's a kind of circular smiley face here, two eyes made of zeros and a mouth made of zeros just here. Now in four color mode, then that's not quite how it works, and two consecutive bits will be used to define the colors just here. So you can see again, we're defining our smiley face with the data just here. Now, when it comes to calculating a memory address to write data to from a screen position, we are going to have to calculate the address from a formula here, and that's what we're doing just here. Now, the Commodore 64 uses a rather frustrating memory address system for the screen. The way it works is within an 8x8 character block, 8 consecutive bytes actually go down the screen, and then the 9th consecutive byte actually jumps up to the next neighbouring character block on the x-axis, and this makes calculating our screen addresses a little bit tricky. So what we effectively need to do is we need to take our x position, our horizontal position in bytes, and multiply it by 8, because remember 8 consecutive bytes will actually go down the screen, and then we need to take our y position and work out, excluding the bottom 3 bits for the lines 0 to 7, which remember are consecutive, and then take the value in those bits and multiply it by 640, because each strip of 8 y lines will be 640 bytes separate from the last one. So it's a bit of a pain, and it does make working with the screen a little bit tricky, but unfortunately, a lot of these 8-bit systems do have very tricky memory layouts for the screen. So you've got a formula here. We're effectively doing the multiplication by 8 using bit shifts. Every time we shift a byte to the left, we effectively double the value in it. And that's a fast way of doing multiplication on an 8-bit system. So that's what we always try and do. So we're doing that just here. And we're storing the X position in D and E here. We're using the accumulator temporarily as the low byte in that pair, and then moving it to E just here. We're now stripping off the bottom 3 bits of the Y position, because as I say, we need to be aligned to an 8x8 character block for this to work properly. And we're then effecting the multiplication again, shifting accordingly, And then we're just adding in the DE that we calculated before here so that we've got the X and Y positions added together. This is now going to contain an offset within screen memory for the pixel we want to change. Now, the next thing we need to do is add the screen base. The screen base is just hexadecimal 2000 here. So that's the start of the screen. And so we're just adding that there. Now this will effectively calculate a memory address for the start of an 8x8 character block on the screen, taking into account the screen layout. As well as the bitmap data, which will be effectively black and white, we do need to set the color information. And the way we're doing this is we're calculating it just here. Now this is a bit easier to calculate. Effectively, each line is 40 character blocks wide, and each character block has a single color attribute. So we're just multiplying the Y strip by 40 and adding the X position, the Y strip being 8 pixels tall, and the X position being 8 pixels wide. So we're just doing that here, and then we're adding the base here. Now on the two color mode, the screen color information is at 0400, but on the four color mode, there is some extra information at D800. And so you can see we're actually defining two destination addresses, one here for the two color mode and one here for the four color mode, and the base and the low byte will be the same in both cases. So we're calculating both at the same time because the size is the same of both. Both have just one color information byte for each character block of the screen. Okay, so those are allowing us to calculate the X and Y position of the color information. So we've got our screen set up, we've got our bitmap in memory because it's defined by those bits you saw just before, just these. And we're now ready to actually start transferring data to the screen memory. So that's what we're going to do now. Okay, so we are loading in the address of the bitmap in our memory into H and L here. We're loading an X position here in X and Y here and running get screen pos, which will calculate the memory address into DE. And then we're going to transfer a set of bytes from our bitmap into the screen. And of course our bitmap is 8 lines tall. So we're just comparing to Y to 8 here to know when we've transferred all 8 bytes here. Now in the case of the four color mode, the bitmap is actually half the width. So it still only takes a single character block. So either way, that's all we need to do to get our smiley onto the screen. Once we've done that, we're now going to do the color information. We calculate the color position of the same XY coordinate. And then on the two color mode, we just write the color information to ZDE. But on the four color mode, we have to write an extra nibble to BC here. Now, one thing to bear in mind is the background color is always the same for the entire screen. So we're only setting three nibbles here. Color zero is going to be defined by the background on this mode here, on this four color mode here. Okay, and that's how we can get our little smiley to the screen. As you can see just here. And then if we just change this code here and we enable the four color mode. Well, now you can see he's a little bit squashed up, but you can see he's in four colors now. Okay, so what about the more advanced Tubico example? Well, let's take a look at that. Well, the first thing is the bitmap. Where are we getting the bitmap from? Well, we're including one of two files depending on our color depth here. And you can see they're actually files we're including with Inkbin. And if you want to get valid files, you can use my AcuSprite editor. If we go to settings here, we do have a Commodore 64 mode. I've not actually defined the colors yet, but it does allow for color palettes. If we just go Alt palette here, I believe that's the C64 palette. So we can define a color palette here using this option and just set each individual block using the ZX paint mode here. And once we've got information we're happy with, then we can just go to 6502, C64, and save raw bitmap. And you can see there's two options here that will both work just fine for today's example. And this is what I use to create all of the files from my tutorials, and it's included in the sources 7-zip. Now, the functions we're using to get memory addresses and that kind of thing are all the same as before, but you can see here we've got the code, which is now much longer because we're doing much more data. And now we're actually having to fill the each of the character blocks with the color information as well as the bitmap information. So let's take a look at the code that actually does the bitmap work here. Well, let's start as the same as before. We're loading in the bitmap into HL here. We're defining some symbols, bitmap width and bitmap height, and these are in character blocks. X position and Y position, which is the screen location. So first of all, we're calculating the screen location of the bitmap as before. That's the destination. We're then loading X with the height of the bitmap we want to draw, because we're using X as a counter for the Y strips. We're doing each strip separately because that works best with the memory locations of the screen. Now, what we're going to do next is we're going to transfer an entire strip to the screen. So this is effectively going to be the width of the bitmap times the height of the strip. And the height, the strip is always 8 pixels tall. And that's what we're doing here, just repeatedly transferring data, increasing Y each time until we've done the width of the bitmap times 8. And then once we've done that, we need to move down to the next line here. So we're just increasing HL by Y because we've already calculated the offset in Y. And then we're adding the height of the strip to move down to the next line in the destination. And what we're doing to achieve that is adding hexadecimal 140, which is 320 in decimal. And that's the width of the entire screen in bytes times 8. And that's what we do there. Now, once we've done that, we're then checking if we've got any more lines to draw, any more strips rather. And so we're just comparing to X here, which we have got containing our height in strips, which is of 6 here, and that will actually draw the image there. Now, once we've done the bitmap data, we now need to do color information. So again, we're calculating the color memory pods from the X and Y position. We're once again using the bitmap height in X here, and this time we are going to do almost the same routine, although this time we're having to add hexadecimal 28, which is 40, because the width in characters is 40, and we're transferring some fixed data. So we're defining our Tubico character is either color 40 on the two color system or colors 4, 3, and 1 on the four color system. Remember, the background color in the four color system is always constant across the image. So these are the colors that we're loading into memory. So it's fixed for the entire image. You could of course make a more advanced one, which was reading in from an extra memory source and transferring different colors to different pixels of the screen, different blocks of the screen, but that's not what this example does. So of course, if we were to change this and change the height of the bitmap to just 3, and we run again, you can see our Tubico character has been chopped in half. So you could use this relatively easily to be a sort of template basis for some code that was going to draw sprites onto the screen as part of a game. Now, of course, that game will be limited to being bound by 8x8 character blocks, but I think that's a reasonable limitation if you're just starting out programming on things. As I say, you can create your own graphics with our sprite editor, and hopefully this will be some help to you. So anyway, I hope you found this interesting. If you have, please go to the website and download the sources, and you can download all the development tools that I've used today. I hope you'll enjoy playing with the C64. Maybe you'll be able to build something interesting from this example. If you want to see more, there's going to be more in this series. We're going to add joystick control to move the smiley around the screen. Also, I've already done the Grime 6502 series, in which I wrote a simple game on the Commodore 64, and you can have a look at that for inspiration, and again, you can get the source code for that. Anyway, whatever you decide to do, I hope you're going to enjoy programming on the Commodore 64, and programming in general, of course. Now, if you want to move on to a different system, I also cover Z80 and 68000 systems, a wide variety of systems. I think it's over 25 now I cover on my website and my YouTube channel. So please have a look around and have a look for the playlists, because each system has its own playlist, so I'm sure you'll find something that's going to entertain you. Whatever you do, though, I hope you'll enjoy programming. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.